Hi, I'm Dan Schmidt. I do a weekly television show called Team Chicago Challenge. It's a motorcycle racing show. The website is teamchicago.tv, teamchicago.tv. I was also the candidate for the 5th Congressional District in the state of Illinois in 2012. I lost that election to Mike Quigley, but when I was traveling around, going to the different fairs, whether it was Bucktown or Wicker Park or Jefferson Park, I talked to hundreds of people. And what I was shocked by is, I don't know if the term I should use would be, ill-educated is a term I'm going to come up with. Ill-educated people, people have gone to college, people have good backgrounds, people that are pretty smart, but when it comes to economics, it's just like nobody teaches economics. I mean, simple stuff. Banking, how does the banking system work? How does our economy work? What makes things work? And I think that a lot of these people went to college, they have good educations, but believe me, I was shocked that people do not quite understand how the economy works. So I'm gonna do clips I'm calling Eco. I did Eco Part 1 or Part A, and now we're going to do Eco Part B. And what I want to talk about today, briefly, in this 10-12 minute clip, is one thing we got to understand is that profits are good. Without profits, there's no business. You gotta understand that. Nobody would put their money up without the potentiality of earning some money, making a profit. No one's gonna build anything if they can't make a little money. No one's gonna deliver a service. Just like you, if you take a salary, you are selling your knowledge, you are selling your physical being, your mental being, for a certain amount of money. But that's, don't confuse salaries with profits. Profits are, you go into business to make a little money. There's nothing wrong with that. But my dear friend, Dave Cargill, motorcycle racer, a guy that I knew, I met Dave Cargill when we were building the IBM building in Chicago. And we were friends for a good 20 years. I haven't seen Dave in the last 20 years. But I still consider myself a dear friend of Dave Cargill. And he was an iron worker. I mean, he was one of them guys that gets up there and puts the iron together on the big buildings, you know, when they're 100 stories up. They're the guys putting the steel together at 100 stories. No safety nets, no nothing. They know what they're doing. These people are very serious workers. They know what they're doing, and they're worth every penny they make. No doubt about it. But Dave one day said to me, so this shows how conservative I was, how much to the right I was, even back then when I was a youngster, when I was in my young 20s, I was conservative then, because Dave said to me, profits are money stolen from wages, or profits are stolen wages. So I'm like, Dave, you gotta be kidding me. If people can't make a profit, there is no business. People can't make a profit eventually after they build these huge buildings. They won't build the buildings. Profits is what makes business work. So I wanna give you a little lesson. We're gonna talk about steel. And if you go through this with me, I think you'll understand that the profits turn out to be such a small amount of the total picture. So let me set my clipboard down. We're gonna put this together. And we're gonna talk about steel. Now Dave was an iron worker. He worked for American Bridge. American Bridge was a subsidiary of U.S. Steel. If you're on the tollway in Indiana, in Gary, you look over, you'll see American Bridge. They got their own operation where they put those beams together. They don't make the steel there, but they put the beams together there. Now, where does steel come from? I want to show you something here. All right. So we got iron ore. Iron ore in the Midwest comes out of the Minnesota area. So to get the iron ore out of the ground, you got to have the equipment, tractors, bulldozers, cranes, shovels, to get the iron ore out of the ground. that all costs money. That's got to be paid for somehow, right? And there's people in Minnesota getting this iron ore out of the ground that are getting paid good wages. So in order to get this iron ore out of the ground, there's people making good money getting it out of the ground. Then the iron ore gets put on a ship, right? And these ships come across Lake Michigan to Gary, Indiana, right? Well, those ships cost millions of dollars. So the dollar's got to come from something. So there's iron ore, which is just dirt, basically, sort of. They put it on the ship, and they ship it to Gary, Indiana. Okay, so the ship comes into Gary, Indiana. Here's Gary, Indiana, right? And they take that, but in order to make steel, you also need scrap iron. So you gotta go to the junkyard over here, junk. And he's been buying scrap metal from people, buying old cars, buying whatever, putting the scrap metal together, breaking it all down. He's paying people. He's got employees that he's paying. So a car that he pays $50 for junk after they take it all apart and they separate the steel out might be worth $150. He's got to pay people working there. So there's salaries going in the junkyard. And then some of the scrap metal also goes to Gary, Indiana. So you got the iron ore going to Gary, Indiana. You got that. And everybody's making money to that point. So all these salaries are being paid. Okay, and it's thousands and thousands of dollars. A ship, a boat that costs millions of dollars is moving it. Okay, so you got scrap metal coming in and you got iron ore coming in. They make the steel. Then they ship it from the U.S. Steel Works and they ship it down the street over to American Bridge. Then you got iron workers making good salary, working for American Bridge right there, right off the tollway, all making great money as they shape these great beams. They make sure these beams are so perfect. These men are such craftsmen. They make these beams, and when the beam gets to the job site, it all fits together. So there's people doing it. How about the guy that's putting together the architect that's lays out the building? And all the people work in the architect's office. They all can make money. They're all making money from this iron ore that's being changed into steel. The steel is made into beams, right? So let's talk about a building that I'm familiar with. I was Coffee Dan right down there at the Sears building. So then it got shipped on a truck, right? So you got a truck here with the beams on the back going down the highway, right? You got a truck driver, he's making money. You got the truck, that costs money. He takes this truck and he ships it over here to the Sears building, correct? Okay. Then not only do you have, you can't put the beams up without putting the caissons in, so you got about 25 different trades, different people, getting the job site ready, whether the guy's doing the caissons going on, they're all making money. The money's got to come from somewhere. I mean, eventually, this building that they're putting up, let's talk that this is the Sears Tower, okay? So the Sears Tower turns out to be 9 individual buildings, all right? So it goes up, there's Sears Tower. So you got the people doing the caissons in the ground, big equipment, that costs money. All these guys are getting paid a living wage, great money. Then you got the carpenters who got to set up everything around the bottom, and then finally the steel. So you got all these different trades working together, all working in one direction, right, to get this building up, right? So finally, from the iron ore, the dairy, the junk, the steel, over to American Bridge, from there over to downtown Chicago, put up the Sears Tower, all these beams, every one of these beams, every one of these little beams that are just sitting up there, and all the holes are done right, so they fit together with the next beam, and they fit together with the next beam. All brilliant people, whether it's the architects working on the design, whether it's the steel workers putting the steel in, everybody's making a good amount of money. So when all this money is spent, all these millions of dollars in salaries, all these millions of dollars for the equipment, for the buildings and all that, then finally, there's a profit somewhere. the iron ore, the company that owns the range, that runs the range, that's paying Minnesota part of having the land, they're making a little bit of money, and the state of Minnesota is making some money. This guy with the ship costs money, but he's paying everybody, but the guy that owns the ship will make a little bit of profit from moving iron ore from here down to Gary. This guy who owns the junkyard, who's been buying scrap, that's putting his money out. Now finally he sells his scrap, it's turned into steel, he makes a little bit of a profit. When you figure what the profit is, compared to all the salaries, to the hundreds of people that are involved, and all these people, every single one of them, said maybe the guy who cleaned the washroom at the junkyard might not be making a living wage, but all these people involved, all making a great amount of money. And Dave Cargill says to me, profits are wages stolen from the workers. Do you understand? Now, I don't know what they teach in union halls. I don't know what they teach when Dave was going through his four-year apprenticeship. I don't know who was putting these lies into his head. But profits is what allows business to exist. The reason the United States of America is the greatest country there's ever been is because people were allowed to keep their profits. And let me end by this. We have a president that every day when he wakes up, in his mind, he is breaking one of the Ten Commandments. Now, I'm not saying he's fooling around, he's committing adultery, I'm not saying he's a thief, but every day he thinks about coveting his neighbor's goods. We were so lucky that when the Ten Commandments were created, that it was inspired by God. The 10th commandment, thou shalt not covet, because the purpose of thou shalt not covet is to allow people to live together. You don't want everybody jealous of everybody else. And our dear president, President Obama, every time he makes a speech, he talks about coveting his neighbor's goods. Well, I hope you learned something. I hope you learned. I was there, Coffee Dan, from the day they put that first case on in the ground. It was great. I knew a lot of great people, a lot of great construction people, and I did make a little bit of a profit. Thanks for tuning in. Remember, teamchicago.tv, walkwithdan.com. If you want to email me, give me a comment. It's teamdan45@gmail.com. And I hope you learned something. Eco, part B, we're going to continue on and teach you about how the economy works in the United States of America.